start with a small story. Okay. Okay. So I don't know if you've heard of how many of you heard of Vachaspati Mishra. So Vachaspati Mishra was a saint or a sage many thousands of years ago, and he was extremely devoted to study of scriptures, especially Vedanta, of text, and he was a very scholarly person, and he was completely devoted to his study, and he wanted to write his own book, his own compendium, his own interpretation, or he wanted to explain it in a better way, just like today we have so many books explaining different topics. So he was fully devoted to his work. Then so he was not interested in getting married at all, that kind of stuff. But as happens, as used to happen in those days, and happens, people around him, his parents, were asking him to get married. So he thought about it, and he said on a condition that, you know, he tells his wife up front, or he tells the girl in question up front of like what his dedication is or devotion is, and only if she is okay will he get married. So they all agreed. So as they started looking around, he was telling that I'm not interested in, I mean, he's basically saying this is what I'm devoted to, I'm not interested in marriage and family and those kind of things, and you know, this is going to be my sole purpose, and if you're still okay with it, then only get married. So there was a very noble lady, in those days, both men and women used to be noble, and she readily agreed. Her name was Bhamati. So the story goes that, and it's a real story, so the story goes that he was completely engrossed in his work, morning to evening, night, and she would help him in whatever ways it needed, like it could be whatever. So that's how time went by. And one fine day, she was getting him, his lunch, and he looked up, and when he was having his lunch, he saw some white hair fallen near his ear, and he was very surprised, and he looked up, and he saw a lady with graying hair serving him, and he was like very surprised. So he looked up and asked, "Who are you? How come you got white hair?" So she says, "I'm your wife," and she says, "You are so busy in your work for these decades that you didn't notice that both of us have grown old." And he was shocked, and he was maybe a little regretful or sad, or he was also extremely impressed with her patience and dedication. And so his book he named on her name, which is Bhamati. So it's a story of single-minded dedication, single-minded devotion to a cause. So we have that story, and we have, of course, one more very, all of us know this other story, which is of Lord Krishna. So you know the multiple roles he played, right? He was everywhere at all places, right? He was a friend to people, he was a charioteer to Arjuna, but he was a king himself, he was a negotiator, he found time to play the flute, he was a student at times, and he plays so many different roles in the Mahabharata and in his life story. And he was everywhere, right? So he was married, he had children, he doted his children, he had many wives. So all kinds of things, and then of course he had time to, or he had good study, he gave the Bhagavad Gita. So you have on one end somebody like him, on the other end like Lord Krishna, and they're really two extremes. So one is a completely single-minded, single task, completely single-minded, and I think you're getting the question, or a multitasker. So who do you really want to be, or who what fits you? Are you like a person who is wants to devote yourself completely to a goal? Are you a single-minded person, or are you a multitasker? So I think there's a question to all of us. But then, just turning the question on the head, is do we really have a choice? Can we become like Vachaspati Mishra, like completely devoted to one goal, one mission in life? Or are we really like, as people, family people, community people, do we have to juggle around really multiple roles? And I think all of us here and most of us, it's not really a choice, it's choiceless. We have to juggle around multiple roles. We cannot really devote ourselves completely to something, because many of us have a family. We want to do multiple things ourselves, even things we want take care of. Or maybe it could be our recreation as well, our health as well, our friends as well. We want to do a lot of things, right? So our hobbies, if we want, this particular question has troubled me a lot, because I was a person who wanted to do many things, and I always felt short of time, short of bandwidth. Always this question of not able to, or should not do this because I'm like no bandwidth, spreading myself too thin. So what do you do? So I ended up spending more time researching how do you do many things, or how do you achieve doing all those things that you want. And this is like, you can think of it as a short collection of my research, I mean, or what I have. And like, so this I've specifically spent the last year and a half trying to research and understand different kinds of perspectives, or how people achieve a lot of things. For example, how Elon Musk manages to run like three, four companies, all of them very extreme companies, not an ordinary company. How Warren Buffett manages to have 22 companies and have built so many wealth, so many people, so many very known and some not so known multitaskers who achieve multiple things in life. Yeah, the question is really how to get more done. So we all have financial constraints, we have a lot of work, we have deadlines. How do we work stress-free and still we get, how should we even change our work, but at the same time, how do we get the time to do things we like? And I'm just showing play, family and arts, but it's just indicative, it could be anything else. This is really the question. Luckily, the question has an answer. Okay, so taking a step back, the very good old days, or in the real, real old days, even before Vachaspati Mishra and those stories, life was very simple. It wasn't as complicated as it is today. The philosophy, the principles, the thinking was very simple, that if you are hungry, look for food. Full stop. There's nothing more to life, right? So that's about it. Otherwise, you were eating food or you were sleeping. That's pretty much it. Then things started changing, and we had something called technology come in. Slowly, 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 things started changing. And not in the not so distant past, things started getting a little bit more, but not really all that complicated. So we could communicate over distances. We had other things to do. And but still, in our parents' and grandparents' day, especially, a letter was an event, right? Getting a letter was an event. Posting, having to send a letter was an event. Like maybe a family would get around and you write something and put it in, and then today I have to post a letter, or maybe next week I have to post a letter, and that's it. That was the task of the day. That was the task of the week, maybe. But again, those simple days are gone by now. Today is, I think all of you recognize this. So this, there has been a study on this, and or rather, people have gone through this, it's not so difficult to study this, but what they've found is that in a morning today, in today's age, in a morning, in just a morning, if you just look at information, right? Information could be in textual, visual. We consume more information than our previous generations did in the entire lifetime. Entire lifetime, in just a morning. It's, you know, we had the information, we had the industrial revolution and then the information explosion, if I may call it. And so this is, not many people are recognizing this, but this is what is happening. We are having an explosion of information. So the old ways of working, the old ways of living cannot continue. We cannot be hunter-gatherers and live in this information age. Nor can we be simple postmen, post-delivery boys and live in this age. We cannot tackle life the same way as previous generations did. And this recognition needs to seep in. It will not work that way, and something's got to change. So again, shifting gears, like today, imagine a bank. Okay, you have a bank today. Suppose there's a bank running, and assume it was running like it was 150 years ago. There's no standardization. You just walked in, like the old age money lenders were the banks, right? You walked in, you talked. There's no real process, there's no real need for any documentation, there's no automation. If you want to open an account, you walk in and he will find some scrap of paper and you write it and he'll keep it somewhere, or the bank teller will keep it somewhere. Imagine trying to run today's bank that way, right? I mean, we sometimes complain about some public sector banks or the nationalized banks being not efficient enough, but then they too have so much of process. They are all online. You can do all your transactions online, and we still feel that they are lacking sometimes, and we still compare some of the more modern or advanced or banks, right? So it's impossible to run a bank without all of that automation and standardization, right? So the truth is, without, when you have complexity to deal with, you cannot handle, without these factors, without standardization, without processes, without systems in place. The thing is, I think all of you recognize this, all of you will say, yeah, of course, we cannot run a bank, but just going back one slide, you know, our life is also becoming complex, okay? And this is something we need to recognize. Otherwise, we will try to tackle things the same way we did 50 years ago, 40 years ago. That's not going to work very well. So just like a bank needs a management system, so also you need a personal management system to organize, plan and optimize your working and your life. And this will help you better or improve your functioning. So this is slowly becoming essential. I would say it's very fast becoming essential, especially if you want to have if you have multiple priorities in life, this starts becoming essential. So what do you need? So what you need is, you need systems, just like a bank needs systems. You need tools to work with those systems, and a lot of it you also need to change yourself in certain ways, which is what I meant by behavior changes, to be able to boost your working. So you need an ideal secretary, right? You need an Alexa and Siri. Alexa and Siri by itself is not enough. You need an Alexa and Siri on steroids. Whatever you think, whatever you ask needs to get done. You need, the industrial revolution gave us a lot of tools, right? We have dishwashers, we have washing machines, we have Burshan, we have microwave, we have cleaning robots, we have light, so many things have come in, and lot of tools. The carpenter has tools, he has the saw, screwdriver, he has got the cutting machine, and so on and so forth. So we all expect these tools to help us, but now our problems are primarily, or our challenges are primarily mind or intellectual, or you know, that kind of thing. And now you need something on your that side. You need a, you no longer are we talking about physical support or physical addition. You need a second brain to be helping you, or you need an extension to your brain, which is what, like, for example, a calculator or your phone, phone organizer is doing. But you need to create this in a far more thought through fashion. You know, you need to create systems, and you need to have, in effect, a second brain to be working for you. Okay, so it's a very simple logic. You know, you need to outsource to the extent that your mind and your brain is empty, and that's where you are successful. So what happens is, many of us see, there is also a class of people who are do not take things on their head, or they do not take the genuine ownership of things, and then they just continue to bungle around in life. But that's not where you want to be, right? You want to be responsible, you want to be responsive, and you want to do what? I mean, they will not achieve much. Many people are in their same jobs in the same way, but it's a very precarious situation, because tomorrow, if the economy goes down, if situations change, they'll be doing something for 10 years, 15 years, and you know, they may find it, as the COVID has shown, they may find it really hard to get things on their heads. Now, if you're not really progressing, if you're not really smart, if you're not really owning up things, able to execute things, we'll have a tough time across the spectrum, even in academia. So if you leave that aside for, but I'm saying that you take the ownership, you take the responsibility, you are able to achieve what you want, you set out on goals, you achieve them, but at the same time, you should be working to keep yourself free and not constantly bogged down by all these things. So nothing on the so it essentially means you have to be clutter free. Things should just go on pretty much in automata. You need to be clutter free, and things happen pretty much on their own. You need to create systems like that. So I'm calling it cloud management. So this is your cloud, or your Alexa and on steroids, or whatever you want to call it. So I'm just showing an example that you're playing multiple roles. You know, sometimes you're on a phone with a friend, sometimes you're doing housework, you're on the computer doing office work, sometimes you just want to enjoy in your in your park or something like that. So you think through what all you want to do, what are your priorities, and you dump it into this cloud. If some thoughts or some things come, or action items come, something you want to do, something you want to look at, you dump into this cloud at any situation, and then you pick it up from the cloud at a point that you want to, right? So when you're working, you pick up what's relevant to work. Suppose you're doing housework, you pick up what is relevant. Suppose you're talking to a friend, or you're job related, you pick up. So you kind of get an idea, right? So this is I mean, everything is moving to the cloud, right? So, I mean, this bubble in the center is indicative of, you know, a central management system, or your personal management system, okay? So this is what it is. So I'm actually not going to a very simple personal management, extremely simple, a first order is just having a diary, right? Just writing down, like, what you want to do, any thought or any notes, or like, I want to shop something today, and you jot it down. Or tomorrow I'm going to cook something for my children, you jot it down. I have to clean the house. So that's an extremely simple personal management system. I need to make these phone calls. So that's baseline, right? Like, a diary is something, but it depends on, I mean, at least you should be doing that at the very least, but it depends on how complex your life is, how complex it is. and the more complex it is, the more you're trying to do, or the more you're spread out, the more complex a system you need. So I was just showing you my my toolkit, but it's not just the toolkit, it's the whole system that you create. So it can be far more sophisticated than that, and I will touch upon it again, but at this point I will just show, for example, this is what I use, and you notice all of them are mostly digital tools, because my cloud is in a digital, but it need not be. It can be in pen and paper, it could be in somewhere else, it could be in sticky notes, it could be in files, it could be in anything. You could create a hybrid system for yourself. The point is, you need to think it through and come up with your own personal management system. And I'm not going to go into the creation of this, though it's a big thing in itself, because it's a pretty it's something that, again, you need to invest in, and you need to spend your time and thought and energy in creating one. So, for example, this is some of the tools I use, which I've noted here. So my ClickUp is for task and project management. Notion is for, it's like a wiki, personal wiki for all my documentation. So for my notes, I'm using Nevo, as well as audio, I've used Dragon, and we use Soho for all. So for example, Notion is very good for organizing data, extremely good for organizing data, but it's not very good for presenting data. You don't get PPTs, you don't get documents out of it. So we use Zoho for that. So this presentation, for example, based on this. So we have actually spent a lot of time trying to research what works, what doesn't work, and how it works, and come up with this kit. So once you have a personal management system, I'm going to just touch upon something beyond. So how else can you become better or more efficient or more streamlined? So I'm going to drop in a few strategies or a few thoughts, few ideas which you can use. So these are very practical ideas you can use. So I'm going to just talk about a few of them. And you'll realize that a lot of issues are common, okay? So I've listed them here, and we'll just run through these. A lot of them I've picked it up from, like I said, multiple places, and some of them are on my own. Okay, so first one is Kaizen. So Kaizen is a Japanese management technique which revolutionized the Japanese industry. So more than anything else, it talks about incremental improvement. Everybody thinks of that big step or big bang kind of thing, but Kaizen specifically talks about incremental improvement. And it could be very small things, like, for example, one incremental could be like, when you're working, you a lot of times you need to refer to multiple things. So you say that, hey, maybe if I had two screens instead of one, my work would be easier, and you invest in an additional screen, and then you find that, okay, the small little niggerhead of this and that is gone. Or you may say that, okay, I have 4-5 email accounts, let me get email solution provider where, or email app which combines, it could be Gmail or it could be something else. Let me start using a calendar tool. So it could be incremental improvement. So Kaizen specifically is incremental increment. And you could again, so when you have your personal management system, a small percentage of your bandwidth can be devoted to continuously improving that itself, right? How do I get better? How do I work better? So that would come in a Kaizen-like system. For example, you have data, and I found this a lot, okay? Many people, again, don't value these things. I recently wanted to, for our science kit, I wanted to order some materials. So there's a person who was a vendor who said that, he was interested in providing it, and he gave a presentation. He's also a startup. He's trying to start his own small venture on the side by creating these science materials for children. And when I went through, and then he wanted to show like what he has done and something, and then in front of me only he was spending 10-15 minutes digging through his present his files, you know, trying to figure out where that thing was, where he had done some innovative or whatever, some products which he wanted to showcase, and saying like, see, I've done this, I've done that. And after 10-12 minutes, he managed to pull it out and he showed me. And at that time itself, I felt, hey, this guy is not organized, I doubt. And he said, I think I had met him on a Tuesday or Wednesday, and he said by Saturday, he will give me a sample of what I was requesting. It's been 3 weeks and I haven't heard back from him. And this is, you know, this is the truth. So he himself is losing his own value or his own business. And, you know, mentally I made up my mind that I'm not going to go with him. I'm going to do it myself. So he's lost a client. I mean, maybe he's not a very big client today, but he, nevertheless, he's lost a client. And I could sense at that point itself, like, hey, this guy is a little disorganized. And especially happens for solo entrepreneurs, right? So you have this kind of, you cannot really have a one person for everything. So, you know, for example, a good file system, you can say, hey, let me organize my files in a particular logical way. I will sit and clean up everything and I will maintain that. That could be one Kaizen step. Okay, home run. So in baseball, this is this terminology used. And if you know baseball, you know that, you know, it's like cricket. You have a person to hit the ball and he hits the ball very hard. And you have to run bases, so there are four corners, and you know, you go from one, unlike cricket where you go up and down, you have this you know, four corners, and you run from one to the next to the next to the next, and you complete that. It's called a home run. So if you hit it hard enough, otherwise you can just go one corner, and just like cricket, you have a run out. If you don't touch another base and that guy catches, he's like a wicket keeper, you're out. So, but if you hit it hard enough, you can finish the home run. So, home run means you complete this, you start on something and you complete it at one go, at one stretch, and you're done. You're home. It doesn't need to be this thing. So, this is specifically for some tasks. And I'll give you an example so you'll understand what I mean. See, for example, one process improvement is I wanted a second internet connection because you're like four people, everybody's on the internet. For me, it's very critical. So I made up my mind to get up, and many times we think of that, right? We want to change our internet service provider. So what we'll do, we will research or we'll ask around. So I started googling around and started trying to see what were the alternatives. So I found a couple, and then I found one which I seemed to like, and so I called it. So what will happen is you will call, okay, so I called them up, and luckily they answered, and they said, yeah, send the files, send your information, right? They're like, your address and address proof and something like that, right? Maybe a cancel check and few things there. So what will say, yeah, fine. Typically what I would have done in the past is, yes, fine, I will send it, and I would have cut the call. But here I stood on, okay? I said, just wait, hold on. And because now I've organized my information, I've organized my file, it didn't take me much time, because anywhere you go, you usually need the same set of things, right? Like your personal data and all that. It's all very neat and organized. So I kept him on the line and I sent him over. It was a good thing. And I said, you know, have a look at it. And he said, and luckily, means, you know, he said, no, this, I need something else. And I said, okay, I will send it over. So then and there, he said, it's fine. So I said, okay, information over. So I said, what else do you need? So he said, he needs some money. I said, okay, wait, I will transfer. Where do I transfer the money? And then again, I said, I don't want to transfer the full amount. I will do it after you install, because sometimes when you pay this money, they just disappear. And then I did my Google Pay. And again, I said, you send me a receipt. And then I said, when are you going to install it? So he gave me some 4 days time. So I put up a task saying 4 days later, you know, if he hasn't come, you have to, or 5 days later, if he hasn't come, you're supposed to call back. And you won't believe this whole approach from starting out to having this internet done, right? I was done. So only thing is, automatically on that day I will get a reminder if he has not come, but from my side the process was fully complete. This whole thing took 9 minutes. Now typically, previously in the past, I would have said, and then, you know, I would have got lost somewhere else, gone doing some other things, then next day I would have tried to remember, or the day after, and then I would have sent a mail, or I would have sent that information, and it would have dragged over days, right? So it takes your mental bandwidth, you know, that, because you have, there is something you have to do, And now it's close. That home run is very important. That you're home now. It doesn't bother you. And if 6 days later he hadn't come, I would have probably looked for somebody else or something like that. But he came. He also came very promptly, and he did. And you know, that whole my time it took was like 12 minutes or 13 minutes in that whole process. There's also a counter example I will give you. But sometimes we're not alert, right? We slip. So there was one person who interned with us for a couple of months, and he wanted to intern again. He was a nice guy, good guy, very good friend of mine. And so, he, you know, interns are good, right? You get somebody for 6 months, he'll help you. And, you know, being we are not like very rich, so they are also not very bothered about cost at that stage. They want a good work. It's a win-win situation, especially if you get a good guy. So this guy was a good guy. So I said, yeah, I'll try to configure a project for you because it's an official project. Your college has things. Send me your CV so I know your strengths and I can see if the project can be tailored. He said, yes, I'll send it to you by tonight and I close the call. And this is where I made a mistake. So I waited, means, you know, after 4 or 5 days, I remembered, or I had this task that, you know, check with him if he hadn't sent it. So 4 days later, I pinged him again. Hey, have you sent it? And, you know, you cannot call. Again, I wait after some time. Next day, when I checked his reply, he said, I've already sent it. So then there was this confusion. And then I figured out he had sent it to one more wrong WhatsApp number. Like, he had sent it to a school number, and school person had not really registered because where the CV is coming from. I said, hey man, just send it to this. So by the time he sent it, then I sent it to our technical person, and it's probably a 20 minute thought process on what kind, just to configure that project thing. And then I this thing it back and went back to him, and then he said, oh yeah, okay, let me go and ask my college. And he sent a mail to a college. Again, 8 days passed and I didn't respond. He said the college has not responded. By the time that whole thing was over, it was 2 weeks. You know, the whole thing was around 20 minutes, and by the time it was done, the college said it's too late. This time for submitting a project for this term is gone. You cannot do your internship. You have to take coursework. He had already taken coursework. So, you know, because I didn't do a home run, it dragged for so long and we lost an opportunity. So, this is, if I had stayed on the call and said, hey, send your CV. Maybe I could have called my team immediately. It was a 20-25 minute discussion together. We could have just done it and closed it right then and there, right? So that is an example of home run. So you need to see their tasks which are capable of it and just do the home run. Okay, so sometimes what happens is there are things which trouble us which we don't like to do. So, and these niggles, right, they will take trouble you for sometimes weeks and sometimes months on end. Something which irritates you, something which troubles you, you don't have the motivation to do it. So you have to hit it exactly the opposite. Finish it off the first thing in the morning, right? So every morning when you get up, you start by completing the worst thing, the thing you dislike the most, the thing which is most critical, which is pending. You know, sometimes these tasks like become long and long and long. It could be anything, right? It could be you want to, I mean, it could be a personal task, it could be a work task. The ones which you are most likely to procrastinate and is not going to get done, just complete. I talked to a friend and he didn't come on this meeting because, you know, I was just taking some tips from him on design, and I wanted him for 15 minutes and he got very irritated. He said, no, I cannot. But, you know, he said, I've been spending weeks, I've been trying to, I mean, he had taken a break from the job and he wanted something, and he's saying, I'm spending weeks on simple thing I'm not able to do, but I realized this was his issue, right? I mean, your day starts and it just drifts, and you know, he has nothing on his, he's not doing a job, he just wants to do some kind of proposal for some, I think, short term or medium term contract, right? And it's just not happening. And sometimes these things happen, and it's very critical as well. And people don't realize that sometimes things just drift during the day, right? You just start off. So the first thing you just complete it, push it and do it. Okay, so that's called eat the frog. It's got a term for that. It is also very, very, so this is, everybody knows about this in the workplace, standard operating procedures, if you want to do something in checklist. But you can get it into your personal life and it really improves something. And a very simple place where I've started putting a checklist is, for example, shopping. So, you know, one way is to be very ad hoc, right? Or something getting over, then you remember to shop, you order that shop. But if you put a checklist saying like, okay, you know, I have these kind of items, right? It could be this set of groceries, it could be this set of things. and then you go through that on a monthly basis, see what is down, and you order that, and you keep building that checklist, right? Like dry fruits, it could be your shaving set or toothpaste, so many things are there. So what happens is, in a month you spend, and you have enough stock for a month. So in a month you spend maybe 20 minutes, and all your shopping for all these long lead items, right, which last weeks or months, right? Like even water, for example, I put on a monthly basis now. I've created a checklist. So only the whole of shopping gets done in around 20 minutes a month or 25 minutes a month. I don't need to drag it throughout the week. Like, oh, I had to buy this. Oh, I had to do this. Oh, this is getting over. That is getting over. It's not ad hoc. So, and you keep adding to it, right? Like rice, whatever it is. And then you do it on a monthly basis. And over time, you know, like in a month. So, you always have some leverage, right? So, if you need 5 kg of rice, you order 6 kg of rice. So, end of the month, you have around 1 kg. So, you slowly do this. So, you have to, you have a little bit of inventory so that, you know, you're not stuck. And then, so then you're left with, you know, the consumables or the perishables, which may be like once or twice a week, but you can condense your whole of shopping, everything, into a very short thing. So that's a place where you could use checklist, and you can use it's an example of a checklist. Standard operating procedure is basically that. Again, I'm just giving an example. Definitely in work it helps a lot. People don't use it as much as you want to. It's basically a combined experience which goes into SOP. But again, you can use it for home stuff. Like you can just, so you, for example, okay, I mean, now with this COVID, we don't have support, right? So, I mean, I don't want to brag, but we've moved so much. I mean, we had a servant maid, we had this thing, and we thought, you know, and still our house is a mess. We didn't have time, but it's really gone so much now that with nobody, no support, everything is run by us. Now we find it's done far more efficiently. So even your cooking, for example, okay, not that I do cooking, can have a SOP that, you know, I will, for example, as soon as I get up, I will first put on rice because it takes time, and then I will cut vegetables parallelly, or maybe I'll put the dove. So you can create a flow, you know, a standard operating procedure which will optimize your cycle and will cut it down. And this is something you have to work at. You have to just think through, like, okay, these are the steps. How do I sequence it? How do I not forget something? Because I do something and I forgot to boil the milk, I forgot to this thing. It could be in cleaning as well, because you have a house to clean, you have laundry, you have garbage, you have wasted food. So many things are there. So then there also you can create. So what you can do is, you can create a flow that these 15 minutes I'm going to do tick, 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 tick. These are the steps, and this is how it gets up. Means, you know, you sequence the steps or you do it in optimized fashion, and you're done for the day. It's not something again which drags on. Or maybe you could say that you have two points, say in the morning and afternoon, which is what I have. Morning I will have something related to the housework, and again afternoon 20 minutes, and then it's all done. The standard operating procedures could be used in any and many things. Okay, I'm giving examples of personal life, but it could be also used in it's very much in professional life. A lot of things can fall into place for this. Okay, bunching. This is a very extremely useful technique, okay, and it's very simple. It sounds underrated, but it makes a huge difference. So anything you do, right, there is what is called as a setup time. Like if I want to drink a glass cup of tea, for example, right? I will have to go into the kitchen, I'll have to find the water, I'll have to find a vessel, I'll have to put it to heat, and then I'll have to put tea leaves, I'll wait for some time, and then so on and so forth. Now, whether I make one cup of tea for myself or I make 5 cups of tea for my family, the time changing is required is very little different. Maybe for myself it takes 14 minutes, for 4 cups of tea it takes 16 minutes. It hardly matters. That's big. But now, if you do that one cup of tea 5 times, that will take 14 into 5, 70 minutes. It will take more than an hour, right? If I do it once and every time somebody asks. So you will say that, hey, anybody wants tea, and you have a tea time and you do it together. So that's an example of bunching, where what you do is you combine tasks of one type into one time. Now, this is a concept you can use in so many aspects of your life. And the most simple, good example of this is communication, right? Everybody is so, you know, connected that you spread your communication throughout the day, morning, evening, and night. And actually, people who do that are the least responsible because they forget. They will send something, they will say yes, like today's meeting also. A few people said yes and they've forgotten already. And I decided not to spend the energy trying to call and remind them, but yeah, okay, and then they forget. But instead, if you say that all my communication, my WhatsApp, my Telegram, my email, you know, any other, my LinkedIn, my Facebook, my Instagram, all my communication I will do in this 20 minutes or 25 minutes in the day, and I bunch it all together. Rest of the day I will not look at all of this. Or, you know, if you are a very communicated person, maybe twice a day, even that is too much. So, you know, this concept that you know, if we are very connected, we are very effective, is completely counter-correct. The less the connected you are, the more productive you are, because you are wasting less time, you know. Otherwise you're just busy trying to respond to messages and you're not really getting any real work done. And very, very, very few jobs need that kind of persist 24/7 connectivity, right? And a good example is the world's richest man. The world's richest man doesn't use email, he doesn't use social media, he doesn't use phone. I think you know who he is, right? He's Warren Buffett. His work style is, he will get up in the morning, he will go on the way, I think he stops at a McDonald's or somewhere, eats a burger. Every day he does the same thing, goes to his office, and what he does is he shuts off everything. He goes to his office, he shuts off himself in a place, he doesn't do any meetings. The only time he used his mail was in 1997. He sent one email, and then there was a case against him for insider trading because somebody saw something, and then he decided not to use email again. So this, and he where he is today, right? So he will research, all he will do is he'll research, and it's very interesting to see his lifestyle and the way he goes about it. He will research, he spends 5 hours reading the company reports, which, you know, we all find extremely boring, their annual reports, the financial data, the news. He has a set of things that he will read, and he will prepare long letters to his CEOs, which he will give at a frequency of once a year, or maybe at the most twice a year. That's it. That's his job. And he's become the world's richest man. So this concept that, you know, if I'm very, very busy, I'm on WhatsApp also, I'm responding in milliseconds, I'm doing this, I'm doing great work, is wrong, right? It means you're inefficient. It just means that. So this, I mean, I'm using this to tell about social media, but the previous example where I gave about shopping, so where you have to go to Amazon, you have to do a Google Pay. There, it has a overhead, right? So it has a 10-15 minute overhead. You have to sit on your terminal, you have to collect yourself, you have to figure out. Now you club all the shopping at one go. So that's an example of bunching, right? So when you start bunching things together, you're claiming enormous improvement in your productivity and time availability. So I have been fairly successful, like, okay, so I will come to my own personal experience towards the end of it. But this has been a very, very good thing to help you. So this is one more strategy. So, you know, in accounts, there's this concept of closing the books, right? At the end of the day, they do this profit loss, and they tally the profit loss, and it's done, and the book is closed, right? Now, what I mean by this is, and this is one of my very bad habits which I recognize, is I will take a task till something I'm doing till 70-80% complete, and then something else will come and I'll drift off. And it's an extremely, it's hurt me very badly. So the thing is, you open it, you're working on it, so either you extend, you don't allow yourself to be dragged into something else, some other interruption, till you close that particular one. And it could be an email you're writing, so you write half the email and then you go somewhere else. Suppose it's a long email or an important email, and then you forget about it, and there's so many other things which will pop up during the day. And you know, like I said, the whole one goal is to keep your mind empty. So what happens is these lingering, you know, so there's one person who's a productivity expert, he calls them open loops. you can also call them hanging chards, you know, if you remember the US election. So hanging things which are like neither there nor here, small, small things to complete, they take your mental energy, they take your mental bandwidth. So if you cannot close the book, you bookmark it, in the sense you have a place where you know you're 80%, just like when you're reading a book, right, you put a bookmark it. So it's again a discipline that you cultivate. So these are some of the strategies. So these are more like, you can say, at a micromanagement level. But you do things at a, you can be very efficient, but you may not be effective, right? You may be doing things, but then what are you doing, right? You may be running around like a headless chicken. You may be running very fast, but then what exactly are you achieving with that? And you need to also be having the big picture in place, and you need to be spending your energy in a very effective manner. So how, you know, easy to say, yes, of course, but then there are tools and techniques to help you get there, right? So that you are your whole time is purposefully, is meaningfully spent, is purposefully spent, and you're not you're drifting, you're not just efficient, but you're also very effective. So I'm just trying to give some overall thinking aids, a top level picture. Getting better, get better at getting better, so you know what your this thing is. So these are some of the things I'm going to touch upon. So the first one is the Eisenhower matrix, and I think many of you may be familiar. So what you do is you sit down and you divide it into two. It's a matrix, right? So vertically into two categories, which is one is urgent and other is non-urgent, and this side is important and not important. Okay, so this is your essentially your firefighting. It's very urgent and it's very important. You got to do it now, right? It could be a client project, it could be an email that you need to respond to, it could be something in your family and that kind of thing. So it's urgent and important, you have to do it, and these are like very time driven things. The second quadrant is called not urgent but still very important. And these are the activities, you know, there is this saying, right? If you have 8 hours to cut a tree, you spend 4 hours sharpening the saw, right? So if you have a very sharp saw, you cut the tree very fast. So that is your planning, thinking, strategizing, working on yourself, improving. Like this, for example, is not a very urgent activity, what we are doing today, but it's important, right? So this activity you schedule, you say I will put aside this 1.5 hour or 3 hours for this, so that I have, it's my development, it's my professional development, how do I improve myself? You have to set aside, if you don't do that, you're firefighting all the time, right? Quadrant one is firefighting. So this is your quadrant two, which is not very time critical, and many people slip out on it and they continue in their bad ways, right? Because things are, it could be, it need not be only this, it could be you're learning something new, it could be so many things. So if it's not urgent for you, so this is the thing. So these tasks you schedule, you plan it, you schedule it, you set up a time aside for it. But the last, these two quadrants are very very interesting. So the third quadrant is, it's not important for you, you know, you don't want to really spend time on it, but it needs to be done. You don't feel it's important, it needs to be done, but at the same time it's urgent, and these a lot of things could happen, right? And so you delegate it. Now this is where life is like, what is unimportant for you could be important for somebody else. For example, a very simple thing could be, for example, filing tax returns or something like that. It's needs to be done, it's urgent, but for me it's not important, it's not my priority in life, right? So then, but then there are people who, for whom it is a priority, they want to specialize in that, they want to specialize in finance, right? So you delegate it to them, you don't spend your time on it, you just give them the information that they need and they will do it, is one thing, right? So these are maybe, you know, previously I would go around shopping and get things. COVID has opened my eyes, because it's not very important for me that I have to do it, right? As long as the stuff comes. So then you delegate it, you try to find somebody or you do it. Nowadays everything is moving online. So you automate it that way. So so you start consciously seeing what can be delegated off. The last is sometimes you have a lot of stuff which are neither important nor urgent. And these are essentially come under the category of distractions. So you have to find your distractions and see if they're really helping you in any way. If they're not, you need to delete them out of your life. And these are like very obvious ones: social media, watching TV, video games, eating junk food. They do not really contribute to your development in any way. You just delete it. So this is one more way to, you know, thinking aid or strategy aid for yourself with picture. So this is called mind map. So what they found is the traditional organization chart kind of diagram sometimes is not very useful. So mind map, basically you start from something, hey, I want to have health, so what are the components of it? So it goes, it is like a octopus, right? You can go anywhere and you can create. So this is just a way to represent your thinking. I can replace this by, like, say, marketing. For example, if you're interested in marketing, or what reason? So instead of just tabulating it, it sometimes is a way to simplify your or put everything in one way. This could be time management, and you know, you could have different things and okay, different components of health, and you know, you kind of just, it's just an example of a mind map. Like, mind map is also fairly very popular. It's one way to think through your issues or your life or your thing that you're looking at or things where you want to improve. It need not be issues on this. The other one, there are many of these. One is a fishbone diagram where you have a very specific goal. It's more like a goal oriented, or you have a specific problem. Like it could be like, for example, I have a problem that my water sensor every now and then goes bad and not able to pump water, and you know, sometimes there's no water just because there's no pump, because there's a problem. And then what is the issue? Okay, sensor is the issue, and I can create a fishbone diagram to analyze. Okay, it's again an analysis tool. It helps you analyze problem into different possible causes, sub-causes, and those kind of, these are very helpful tools. And so start, it kind of opens your eyes, it builds in clarity into you, like how to approach something. If you're stuck, right, and sometimes you don't even know you're stuck, these kind of tools are very helpful. So sometimes we get, like I said, we get very caught up in the minutiae of life, right, the details of life. So it's very helpful to step back and see, you know, if you had an impossible goal, and they've used this terminology, it's called bhag, which is a big, hairy, audacious goal. Okay, and I think it's just you read it, you'll understand why. So you step back and think, like, hey, what is my big, hairy, audacious goal? What is, and most people will think money. I want to become a millionaire or something like that. But it could be money, but it could be anything else as well. I want to be able to do 100 push-ups. I want to be able to run the Bangalore or Mumbai marathon or some marathon. What is your bhag? You know, so you think, and what you value is what you value. What you value may somebody else may not value, and you think about it and you actually put it down. But this is my my goal. And You put a goal, you put a time frame for it, because then you prioritize, right? Like Sachin Tendulkar could become Sachin Tendulkar because he prioritized. His bhag was to become the best batsman in the world, and that was his goal. Otherwise, he would have got lost. So my exams are on the corner, I need to study, I need to go this, which textbook, which notebook, what is that going, what is the question paper. He could have got lost in so many minutiae, right? But he had a bhag, right? So if you have something, then only you can do it. And we all get lost. So sometimes you need to sit back, or at least once you need to sit back and think, what is my big goal? Where do I want to be? And how do we approach things to do, right? So there's this typical way, and which I also had this wrong notion of looking at something from a money perspective, okay? How much money does it take? It's a very limited way of looking at things, or how much money am I going to earn. The way to look, the right way to look at it is, it's called a T framework, and this I shortened some podcast. So if you do anything, to achieve anything, you need three things. You need to put your time, you need to have your energy, and you need to pay attention to what you're doing. Only if you have all these three coming together is that thing done or done well. And these are the, when you look at something, right, like I have to do this thing, say I have to do a book now, for example, or I need to create a workflow now, how much time will it take? But not just time will it take, or if I have to delegate it, how much money, but how much of my energy does it take? Is it a high energy thing? Is it a light energy thing? And how much of my attention it take? Something need a lot of attention, something may not need too much of attention. And also, where am I, when you look at yourself personally, right? Am I always finding myself short of time? No, I don't have an energy problem. I don't have a focus problem, but I'm always finding myself short of time. And then you can go back and see, you know, use the Eisenhower matrix to see which, is it Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 you're going on time. No, I have time, but I always feel lack of energy. And then maybe you could use the health kind of mind map to see where my energy, how my energy is going, what drains my energy, what gives me my energy. Maybe I have time, I have energy, but then at the end of the day, I feel I haven't achieved anything, which is an attention problem, which is a strong problem I had. I used to get very distracted, and I still do, but it's improving, you know. So then it's an attention problem, and sometimes I don't get distracted with typical distractions. I get distracted with other work or looking at new things, you know. That's a very strong distraction. You always try to go behind new things. Then you start recognizing that, hey, okay, I have an attention problem. I don't have so much of a, I have a time problem, but it's not, I have 24 hours in a day, it's quite a bit of time. 24 hours is a huge amount of time, actually, when you start thinking about it, or when you start using your time well. A lot of people have attention problems and they don't recognize it. So you need all three, these are the three pillars, you know, of productivity. So, there is this story of, not a story again, this is actually comes from some US senator, his life lessons. So when a lion, right, so a lion needs a meal, right? So, you know, if a lion hunts something, it will hunt, and that's the meal for, I think, 2-3 weeks, I don't remember exactly how many, for a long time. So if a rat were to go near a lion and, you know, go to go squeak, 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 a lion can eat a rat. It is a non-vegetarian, right? It can kill the rat and eat it as well. But you'll be surprised that the lion ignores it completely. Because in the lion's logic, the energy to hunt the rat is not at all worth it. He will be immediately hungry, and will squeak around and run around. It just, of course, I mean, this is a very non-vegish analogy, but conceptually, it's just look at the logic behind it. If you look at a lion, it will only run after the big stuff, right? Because, and it will run, it will hide, it will sprint. It puts in a lot of thought, energy, and focus in going after the big ones. Again, for me, I observed after some time that I was spending a lot of my focus on hunting field mice or small mice, and not really going after the big things, right? So there are big rocks, right? For what you're doing, for example, could be getting a good job, could be the big right, but you're busy, you get lost or distracted. So, you know, like, for example, a job could be your antelope, right? You want a job, say, double the pay. I'm just giving. So what all do you need to do that, right? You hunt big, you don't hunt small. Or it could be so many, it could be any other goal. So, you make sure you're not getting lost in small thing, and you're after you are spending your energy in big things. It could be like, for example, for us, so spending so much energy on that, same energy we spend on getting a big investor, you spend short spending all the energy on, and then everything else falls in place. So those kind of thought process, right? That's called Hanta Anula. Visualization is also a very useful thing. I mean, this is there in meditation culturally, like you visualize how you want things to be. And when you start visualizing how you want things to be, it could be how your day wants to be or how you want to see yourself 3 months later, 6 months later. If you make that a habit or practice or thing, over time you automatically start drifting towards that. It starts happening because subconsciously it kind of, you start going towards that. So visualization is one more thing. So like I said, I wanted to split it over 2 days because there's like a lot of content, and I think it's more a lot of internalization and implementation which makes all the difference in these things. So I was just putting it out there, kind of just collating it and putting it out there. Now we are going to talk about oneself. So it doesn't help just to have the tools and the systems in place. One also needs to better oneself, right? It's a marriage. It's a marriage between you, tool, and the system. So all three have to work in tandem. And so what is it that we need to work on? So I have basically seen a lot of the people like who have been very successful, like from Elon Musk to Warren Buffett, whoever you think of in whatever, most of the fields of life, and especially in today's time and age, they have certain rituals. Now by rituals I don't mean, I mean we are very familiar with rituals in terms of our culture, but they are also were there for a certain reason. Those rituals were also there for a certain reason, and but the kind of rituals I'm talking about are like a weekly review, for example, reviewing how your week went, what you're planning for next week, were you able to do that, what you plan to do. A daily ritual, like maybe in the beginning of the day you plan out a task, end of the day you take a snapshot. So those kind of rituals, maybe a quarterly, you do a deep down, you take time out, you employ some thinking aids to think about what you're doing, where you're going. So those kind of rituals is what I'm talking. And rituals are like a rudder in a boat. Without that, you don't even know you're drifting. You don't even know where you're going, what you're doing. And there is enough said about these things. So there's just one of the many quotes. Failure is just a direct result of a collapse in self-discipline to do little things every day. This, we always have this big bang, right? Sachin Tendulkar is like, wow, what a batsman, world record batsman. But to get there, he's done a million things every day, or MS Subbulakshmi or whoever, right? It doesn't happen. Consistent high performance does not happen overnight. It is the power of persistent practice in some form or the other, and that is one of the most important things we need to incorporate in our life. Now rituals doesn't mean that you have to get overly regimented. You just need those anchor points in your life. It doesn't mean that every minute of your day has to be planned or has to have a ritual, but you need to have the correct balance. So having those anchor points steers you in the right direction. Yeah, this is a very, very bad habit among Indians. We verbally commit and then it just goes into our, absolutely goes into RAM, and God never knows whether it's going to stay there or it's just going to disappear. The only people among Indians I found who are pretty good at taking down notes are carpenters. So they will immediately take out one pencil and they will start writing down the measurements. But it is such a poor thing, and this is one place where I found a big difference between Europeans, Japanese, and Americans. Even they make a note. It sounds very trivial. So we are very, we are all ideationists. We try to ideate, we try to philosophize, but then there's no action item. This happens at the very local level to the very national level. A lot of thoughts, a lot of ideas, but eventually no real action takes place because nobody bothers to take down notes and create a concrete plan. So like I said, in the initially itself, right, you want a second brain means you need to dump, right? You need to tell your secretary, in which case your secretary could be a notepad or it could be a task manager or whatever it is. So some for more advanced forms, you can just make a voice note. I mean, now we have apps which will even help voice notes, so that the laziness of trying, oh, I have to open a pen and paper or something like that. You have to know, have a note, and then you need to organize it well. So this, and then of course, it's not going to make a note and throw off the paper, that doesn't help, but make sure it gets into our system in a way that you can get it back. So it's the minimal things you keep in your head, your brain is free for more productive work. Okay, this is a very straightforward logic or simple logic. The more you are more available to challenge the problem or look at the problem at hand, the more your backup system is taken care, right? So you're more available creatively, brainstorming or focus on the issue at hand. Because if you have a lot of things floating in your head, you have to make that call, I have to there is that small update to be done, there is this correction to be done in that mail or in that book or in that presentation. The more things are floating around in your head, the lesser you are really productive for that moment, because you'll invariably be doing some other task at that point of time. So David Allen has a very nice quote. He says, "You can achieve anything in life, but you cannot achieve everything." If you want to become a cricketer, yes, absolutely. You start at whatever age you start, and then you practice, 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 practice. But for Sachin to become a cricketer, he sacrificed something. He sacrificed his academics. He sacrificed, or he didn't go to enjoy. He didn't see movies. So many things, or have junk food. So many things. He is successful. One perspective of saying you're successful, to become successful at something, is not what you do, but all the non-doing or what all you didn't do. That is what can, one way to look at it. It's an interesting way to look at it. So, I mean, I'm just taking one example, okay? Tendulkar became Tendulkar because he did not bother about studies, he did not bother about movies, he didn't go and have food, ice creams. He actually shifted his house to be closer to the cricket ground. His parents were staying away, so he didn't bother about family that much. I mean, not in the sense he this thing. So he became what he became because all the things he didn't do, right? So in our case, right, so we are probably not looking at becoming sports people, so like, oh man, what's the point? So the thing is, you can also achieve many things, but you can achieve them sequentially. You can become a cricketer, and then maybe you can become a manager, you can become a golfer like Kapil Dev has come, but you cannot do all of it simultaneously. Similarly, when you're working, you can do one thing. It could be in a slot in time, or it could be in a day, or it could be in a week. This thing, and today's world is a very funny world. There's so many opportunities, so many possibilities, and there's so many things to be done. But what has happened is because of the digital explosion, right? The number of possibilities are also many, many, many more. So a lot of times you're distracted in work, and as it happens to me a lot, you're distracted by other work. You're not distracted by other things out of work. You're distracted by other work. You have to be very careful, because there's so many other things, so many things you could do in your work, so many people you could talk to, so many like suppose, for example, you want to look for investment, there's so many places you could go, right? And then you start on one trail, then after some time you start another trail, I mean, each aspect is like that. So there are so many possibilities, and that itself can take away your focus. And not to speak, of course, the distractions are also a many more distractions today in terms of, basically today's world has become that everybody, attention is the currency, right? If they can get your attention, they're making money. It's as simple as that. So everybody is trying to grab your attention in some way or the other. You have apps, they'll be sending notification. Nobody wants to sit quiet. Each guy, anything I take, I get a notification, I will get email. By mistake, I ordered something. I'm just using the name from Apollo Pharmacy like 6 months back, I think. Till today, I keep getting their WhatsApp messages. I think the other day I managed to block them. And so many people are trying to do so many things, and it's all just to grab your attention. At the end of it, for you, for them, your attention is money. For you, giving your attention is basically distraction. Is taking you away from your goal. So distractions also a lot, and I'm seeing this more and more, especially at college. And I've seen people who are otherwise very capable, or at least reasonably capable, but are completely distracted. Remember the time, energy, attention framework, right? So they have time, they have energy, but they lack attention. And sometimes they are pretty intelligent, or they have some skills. Like they may have people skills. I mean, there was some study which said that, I mean, and there's also another app which tries to, there are a lot of apps now which try to help you focus, and they cut off all these distractions. And in their advertisement, they say that every minute, and they will also send you mailers, and they're also, it's kind of funny, they themselves are trying to grab your attention to tell you no, don't get distracted. So one of those people had put a study of, they said that for every 1 minute you get, you lose track, it effectively you lose 23 minutes of your time. It's not just the time you spend, it breaks your flow. Most importantly, it breaks your flow, it breaks your priorities, because you have thought of like, I'm going to do these things today, and then you get distracted. I'm going to do this thing in the next 10 minutes. It has a very, what do you call that, snowballing effect, which we sometimes don't recognize. And we really don't know what we are capable of, okay? That is the whole problem in life. So whenever you take something, when you eat something, right, your stomach has to process it, right? Your stomach has to digest it and then figure out what to take, what to intake, and what to throw out. But so is your brain. Your brain is also a stomach for information, right? So the moment you ingest something, your brain has to process it. It will process, like if you see a movie, your brain will process it. It will process in the background. So there is a, if you consider your brain to be a computer, bandwidth, CPU time is going in. It's not the time you just saw it. It is taking up background processing space. And if you're into execution, both task and time discipline is very important. And I'm not saying you should not take breaks, but it needs to be within. Needs to be contained, okay, within time and space. And we are like, we are quite stupid, in many ways as Indians, because we have all this philosophy, all this theory, we know how to build, concentrate. Can you hear me? I'll just change my mic. Some noise in the background. Okay, is that better? Because there's some background noise, that's why. So, for example, this, all these CEOs, like Twitter CEO, right? He meditates 2 hours every day in the morning so that his brain is all clear and he's focused. But he wants to try and ensure you are on Twitter every minute, every second, right? It's pumping out something. So these guys are very clever that way. Like you have this drug mafia, right? They never
take drugs themselves, or they never become drug addicts themselves. They're just passing it for money's sake. So these guys are also like that. They themselves are pretty focused. They are well. All these guys are well planned. They have a plan in place. They're pretty. Even Elon Musk, though he's technically brilliant, his time management skills are excellent. He plans his day in 5-minute increments. See, we don't realize all of this. He's got a fantastic routine which he lives by. So all these guys do it, okay. But then they and Mark Zuckerberg is probably one of the most unsocial guys in the world, right? And which is why he's able to get that energy and time and focus to run Facebook. If he was a very social guy, he would have never come up with Facebook. So you need to understand the irony here, that these guys, they are trying to take your attention, but they don't succumb to it themselves. So again, if you want to do stuff, be organized. Minimalism and be clutter-free, both physically and digitally. And physically also makes a big difference. Keep one eye on process improvement. And like I was saying, you edit yourself, your time, energy, and if very relevant money, but time, energy, and attention is going. So occasionally you need to audit and know where. If you don't, you know, what gets measured gets done. So if you don't know where it's going, you... you don't, you don't know how effective you are. I pretty much my efficiency is around 20-25% is what I figured. Like if I take a day and if I try to figure out like what I did and I put back a time, like this should take 15 minutes, this should take 20 minutes. The other way around, you know, I account for only around 25% of my time I feel is being used well. So humans have a very unique feature which makes us human beings, right? If it's not, people mistakenly say that we are more intelligent. Yes, we are more intelligent, but it's not a unique human feature. Everybody, chimpanzees are intelligent, dogs are intelligent, but to a much lower degree, that's all. So it's not like it's a unique feature, it's just that we are maybe miles ahead, but animals also have intelligence. They also are capable of making tools, they're also capable of vocalizing, understanding commands, but to a way lower degree. But what makes us very uniquely human is our ability to reflect. So you need to, like I said, now, I mean, what's, you need to spend your energy and time on what's important for you, and you work towards that. You need to reflect on a periodic basis. Yeah, and so we talked about pretty much all outer stuff. Again, like I said, we are really a little stupid because we have the best IP, the best intellectual property when it comes to inner development, which we completely ignore. God knows for what reason. I mean, now meditation is becoming very mainstream. All these big guys, everybody meditates a little bit here and there, but that is just the tip of the iceberg. And this also, for those who are in this, who have been connected in some way, in the 50s and 60s, it was very much frowned upon. It was considered something weird and exoteric or something like that. And then one of the Indian gurus, right? I mean, they get a bad name, but he went and he got tests done in a lot of these U.S. universities, which proved how effective it is in improving focus, productivity, and stuff like that. And slowly over a period of decades, it's become mainstream. But the funny thing is, we ourselves neglect it or don't look at it. It's not so straightforward. If you sit, it doesn't, you know, if it was very straightforward, everybody would be doing it. It's not just like I have to sit with my eyes closed. It is again a field of study in itself. So what does it give you? You know, it gives you so many things. I have not even listed, but the whole purpose of the Indian spiritual thing is to build, you know, what they call a sattva state, right? Tamas, rajas and sattva. So which is a state where you're more calm, you're more composed, at the same time you're more fresh, you're more alert. It helps you build clarity. It helps you become constructive instead of becoming negative to situations. Very important. It helps build your energy levels, builds focus, makes you more self-aware so that you're more capable of making self-improvements. So even at a very practical and pragmatic level, and especially in today's world, because it's all becoming a mental game, right? And this is where it works out. So this is one area which we tend to slide, thinking that what is there. And this concept that yoga, or it's called yoga, but the right word is yoga, is just another form of exercise, is also very, very misplaced. Again, very, very unfortunate that the understanding and the techniques and the development that has been done, we ourselves neglect. But I'm just giving one quick summary of its purpose can be threefold, right? I mean, it works at so many levels. It works at the body level, which is what most people know, but it works at the body level in ways which any other exercise system just cannot work. It cannot even think of it. For example, you have fever, or you have, you know, you're down with coronavirus, you cannot go for a run, right? You cannot do push-ups. But in yoga, there is something you can do. There's always something you can do, especially in this system that, which is more classical, the classical system. And even in the ancient books, it's mentioned that sick, old, any person can do to develop themselves. There's no other system which helps you develop yourself. It's all mostly like an exercise routine. So again, it's one activity worthy body. So you want a body which you can do any activity you want, right? I mean, that's, otherwise it's a burden on you. Traffic worthy breath. So we again feel like, what is there? I breathe every day. I breathe every minute. But I think coronavirus has taught you the importance of breathing. Now, what we don't realize is, yes, we breathe, but the quality of our breath, this is completely missed or slighted by everybody, including the modern medical professionals. And if you become self-aware, you realize most of the time you're breathing maybe 30% of your capacity. It's shallow. It's your lungs could take in and exhale so much, and you are probably doing 30-40% of it, especially when you're sitting in front of the computer. And it has a lot of repercussion, right? I mean, your oxygenations are low, your brain is not getting all your systems, all your organs, including your brain, need it. This sounds so simple, but everybody misses it, again, because they don't have that perspective. It's only this thing. And of course, it works in the mind, like I said before. So, you know, coronavirus has, not just coronavirus, but I think if you've been around, if you've just noticed that by now, at least, it's very clear that medical science doesn't help you for health, right? It may at best prevent you from dying, but it cannot give you health. In worst cases, and a lot of times it doesn't help. And medical procedures are now the fourth leading cause of deaths, and a lot of times they make things much worse. It is not it does it is not a solution actually. If you want a healthy life, it does nothing for a healthy life. In fact, in a lot of cases it makes it worse, but still people are so stuck with it, or you know, centered around it. You know, all this coronavirus pandemic, it's all about hospitals, it's all about, you know, medical infrastructure and this and that, but nobody thinks like, you know, how do I build that immunity margin? How do I build a margin, right? A person with a good immune system, a healthy system, has more margin, all other things remaining the same, to tackle coronavirus, right? It's like a very well-developed country, right? If it has enough hospitals, enough medical capacity. So if coronavirus strikes them, you know, they have the ability to handle. But whereas a very poor country who has no medical staff, very poorly run hospitals, no oxygen cylinders, they will struggle, right? So a developed country has margin. But similarly, at an individual level, if your systems are operating at only 30% of a capacity for day-to-day life, you have a lot of margin. So even if it comes, your system has ability to strike it. But on the other hand, if you're down, I mean, I'm just giving an extreme example. Say you already have heart problem or you have something, you have very little margin then to fight the problem. And people don't think, how can I increase my margin? That's something completely again missed by everybody. We've become so dependent, right? Somebody, the only way is somehow you have to lie in a hospital and then you become better. That is not true. So again, this system is the only or system which kind of works on improving you at that level, at your hormonal level, at your so many different ways. Okay, so that was about how so many ways we can work on yourself. I wanted to talk about project management a little bit, and actually Savita had asked for it, but she's not there today. But nevertheless, I will just run through this. So what is a task and what is a project? So in this context, so a project is it's just a simple, this thing is a longer term task. I mean, that's how we typically define something quick and is a task, a set of tasks. A project will typically have a larger goal and a set of tasks. So it is subjective. I mean, somebody can say this is a task, this is a project. But I would say that something is typically which needs more than one person and maybe more than a few days of work should be classified as a project. So now with task management, I'm going to just touch on three things. Getting things done, which is the David Allen's methodology, to-do list, which we are all very familiar, and Kanban, project, agile, waterfall, and Gantt charts. So the simplest task management tool and most used, and at least this should be used, you know, just to have a to-do list. And this itself is fairly effective. You don't need something. You need something more sophisticated, yes, but at least you should have this. So just a set of things to do. So in a Kanban system, right? Probably originally it was more at the board level, but then you have apps which do the same thing. So you push things in a pipeline, like in a train. So you start from, so this, you could put whatever statuses you want. And you just push it from one status to another until it's out of the loop. So that's a Kanban system. So slightly more sophisticated. So you may need to know, like, it's not just have I checkmarked or not, but sometimes it has in-between statuses. So in a Kanban system, it's kind of a pipeline, continuously moving pipeline. So this GTD is David Allen is one of those gurus of productivity, and he came up with this system, and it takes some time to internalize this. His point is, anything that comes at any point of time, anywhere, you look at that, you know, if it might be a thought, it might be a conversation, you see if it's an actionable thing. If it's not actionable, So if it's yes or no, if it's not actionable, then also, you know, it's not like you talked about a movie and you don't care really, you know, what happened. So it's just trashed. But in certain cases, you don't know whether what to do with it. So it goes into this incubation thing, and you just put it there. You know, it's a bucket list, and at some point you come back and think about it. Maybe an idea, it may be something you want to do. You may want to, like, a thought comes, I want to learn chanting, for example. So, but not right now. So I put it in incubation folder or place or something like that. Or file, so to speak, and then I look at it sometime, and or it could be a piece of information, like I found a good source for organic food, so it's a reference, I put it somewhere, or it's an actionable thing. So if it's something that is a very quick action, you know, I have to send a message which is less than 2 minutes, you just do it off rather than store it, or you delegate it off and then you're done. If it's a bit longer thing and something props up, you defer it and you put it either in a calendar or in a ClickUp, like we use ClickUp and stuff like that. If it's a, I mean, again, you have projects where you have what I talked about, task and project. And he's got this five-step process to look at anything. He calls it capture, clarify, organize, reflect, and engage. So you'll see that there's so much of work to make you productive. Okay, so anything that comes, you capture it, then you clarify, which is the second step, what to do with it, and finally anything, any concept, any idea, any brilliant strategy becomes, you clarify to a point that it just becomes a series of implementable steps. So that's what he says. That is your process of clarification, and it becomes a series, and then you organize it. So you have to put it, remember that cloud picture I gave? So you put it where it belongs so that you can retrieve it at any point of time. You need to reflect, and this is where the power of ritual comes in. Otherwise, you lose it. You may incubate things. You may put in reference. You may need to reflect. And he doesn't call it doing. He calls it engaging. So you engage with that particular task or particular item. And this is again a continuous process. So he's perfected that. So good old Microsoft project, right? So this is, I'm coming to project. So this was about tasks, and now I'm coming to project. How do you run projects? So the good old Microsoft is it's called a waterfall model, because it just falls one by the other. And this is something very straightforward to understand. You start from a requirements. Project requirements, you go to design phase, you conceptualize the design, you architect the design, then you implement it, then you go to verification, you verify if everything is fine, and then, you know, you give it out or you're into maintenance mode. So this is a very traditional Microsoft project kind of model, right? So you do this. Now this is how you would think of, like, you want to build a house, you would go and find out what are the requirements. It's 2-bedroom, 3-bedroom, you need so many bathrooms, you need whatever, you need a gods room, and so on and so forth. And then you think, you get the gathered requirements, you come up with different architectures, and you select a design, and then you start building the house. So this is a very standard flow. But over time, what they found was this didn't work. And where it didn't work was in places like in software development, because by the time you gathered the requirements, and then you thought about the design, and you did all this, so many months and years had passed that by the time you reached here, somebody else had a better solution, and you are completely at sea again. I mean, nobody wanted it, because you started at a point in time, and by the time you came out, it's past its due date. So which is why a set of people came, and they call it the agile model or a scrum model. So the model is a little different, and you need to understand this. So they also developed their own language, okay. They call it sprints. Now sprints is not exactly running. You can think about it as projects. So the project could be anywhere between 1 to 4 weeks, but it's fixed. So the difference in the previous case is you think of all this and you plan it over a period of, like, whatever, months or years or something. You have a plan. Here, it's not the case. Your time is fixed, not your this thing. So this is a little, in that sense, a Kanban-ish, okay, that so you keep running these sprints every 2 weeks. And what you do is you get a lot of, say it's especially suited for software, right? You get a lot of feature requests. So you create a product backlog and say, like, for example, something like ClickUp, right? So they want to keep adding features. They want to keep giving more and more things. So you'll have a product backlog. And you decide, okay, my sprints are fixed at 2 weeks. What am I going to do in these 2 weeks? Okay. And so that 2 weeks you have a backlog and you start working. Okay. Tuck, 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 tuck. You complete it. At the end of those 2 weeks sprint, you review it. So while implementing, as part of it, there's a daily, what it's called as a stand up meeting. Every day is, and you know, everything is like, you need to have 20 minutes exactly, or short and sweet kind of thing, and everybody comes this thing, and this whole thing is carried by a scrum master, equivalent to a kind of project manager. And then at the end of your 2 weeks, you see what happened, what didn't happen, how much you planned, how much you did, and over time you perfect your thing, so you become very predictable. Okay, this 2 weeks you look at the sprint backlog and say, this is doable, this is not doable, in so many people in so much time. So it becomes an engine, you know, like you are able to churn out things on a planned and predictable basis on a very regular basis. So this is the agile model. And this is also a derivative of Microsoft Project. So this is something in between, in the sense that you have this dependencies. So it's not exactly waterfall in the sense one exactly after the other, but then there may be a lot of cross dependencies. This task should be before this should. Personally, I've seen that this becomes so complicated that very few people actually follow it, or yeah, it needs a dedicated person, and we don't do tasks so well anyway, so it goes out of whack pretty soon, and it's a struggle to get it back. This itself becomes a full-time job, but anyway, we are all familiar with this Gantt chart. So this is about task and project management. So I'm just touching the surface, giving a overview of what is currently in vogue. So I mean, this like Agile, for example, they've all exploded in terms of, they have so many variants and so many people do so many variants, and then so lots of stuff happening there. So like that. Okay. So again, I'm shifting gears. And we are going to look at work itself. Now, this is also one of the very funny things I found is in education, two of the most important things in life is how to take care of yourself, or how to manage yourself, and to how to manage your work. Both are never taught. Okay, go to any college, any school. It's so strange. It's never taught how do you manage, how do you work. The core thing itself is never taught, and you're taught everything around it. You know, you're given a lot of theories, a lot of gyan, but how do you work itself is never taught. So let me give you a brief preview of this. Yeah, so I have three aspects. So anatomy of work. So you can classify work into different things, right? Like you can classify as things which are self work, and we can classify it as face time work. So I'm just, when I say self, I'm saying cave time. You know, you go into your own cave, and the things that you can do only by yourself, or you should do only by yourself. The things you cannot do by yourself, like this presentation is a face time. It has to be, but when I was creating the presentation, it was a cave time. I was doing it by myself. There can be deep work or shallow work, you know, your maybe mundane work or errands, like, you know, I have to make this phone call, or I have to send this mail, I have to blah, 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 blah. Doesn't need more deep thinking. I need to check up my mails and all that is shallow work. Deep work is okay. I'm trying to plan a new strategy, or I'm trying to research something. I'm trying to figure out a new way to do things, or I'm trying to understand something. This can be deep work. Based on Eisenhower matrix also, you can classify work as whether it's a Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. We never do that. One more way which I like to look at is it IP development? Like, For example, this or my our education methodology or our education programs or IP development. But then when we want to put it across or our workflows is IP development. But and then the second phase of that is IP dissemination. You want to give it out to people, to public. So that could be one way of looking at work. Yeah, R&D around is a little like deep and shallow. It's a quickie. It's a 5 minute task. Some based on time, you know, this is going to take a couple of hours. No, this is a very quickie thing. Let me just do it off. Could be database. Because a lot of our work, actually, we are creating data. We don't realize it. So are we creating data or are we just trying to reorganize existing data? I figured out that I'm spending so much time trying to just reorganize existing data than creating new ones. Still going on. Like our books is just data organizing. We're just trying to do a good job of the data which we have generated. The concept, the IP about it has been around for more than 2 years now, but only now we're trying to reorganize it so that it's capable of dissemination. So it kind of alerts you like, hey, where am I spending my energy and time? So this is one way of looking at it. Anatomy of work. So just like this, it has a head, it has a body, and it has a tail. This is one way of looking at it, okay? And body will have, of course, where the core of your work is done. It's an extremely helpful way of looking at it. So what is head, what is body, and what is tail? So head is you know, the head of it, right? Where you plan it, you strategize it, you envision it, you conceptualize it. It's you think it through, right? So this is where you do all the planning upfront. Okay, so all this thing is part of the head. You think of what if scenarios, you know, risk mitigation and prototype, dummy run, and so forth and so forth. So body is where you actually do the work, the meat of it. And you know, it can be pretty layered, in the sense you like, for example, going back to that architect example, an architect is planning the house, but in that planning the house also he can have a head, body, tail, where his output could be just the architectural diagram. The bigger picture of building the house, that whole architecture itself is the head, but within that also you have, so I'm saying it could be this thing. A body is actually doing to the work, you know, the meat of it, so the various aspects of it. And then very important is the tail, that your work is done in a neat manner. And neatness is, you know, I'm calling it crisp, thorough, and complete. And this is what really brings value. This is what is paid, right? I mean, when you go to a graphics designer and you will get the same job for 100 rupees and some guy will charge 1 lakh rupees. A lot of the difference is this, you know, the detailing. It's something where I never realized in this field also it's required. Of course, in my field, which was in building circuits and chips, this was extraordinary. This was everything, right? Like in, it's all about detailing, right? So tail is detailing, and you find these loose ends of some other people which really trouble you, right? They will have something, they won't tell you where the thing is, or there's some missing links, and that really troubles everybody else. And it's the difference in quality is essentially this, right? When we say a Japanese product is good, when we go, you know, a lot of people like to go to US, or they feel like wow when they step in, but they rarely think like what is making them feel that wow, right? Which is what I used to think, like what is it that makes, and the word for that is detailing, right? When they plan their cities and they plan their roads, they take a good care of detailing, the way the roads merge, the way they this thing, and it's not at all complicated. It's just that people here are not taught about it, or they're not trained, you know. And in our education system, there's no project management, there's no work management, nothing of that happens. When you have children, right, you have a small child and you buy a Lego toys for him and you show it to him, you know what he does, right? He will put a few pieces here and there, and then he'll splash his hands around and done, you know, I'm done playing, he'll create something. Unfortunately, adults also do that with work. I mean, I've seen so many people, right? You give them a website, they splash around, they'll try to code a few things here and there, and then that's it. I've done it. They want to get to the meat of it, splash around, and that's it. The thoroughness is not there. Completeness is not there. And if you tell them, and it surely irritates or troubles the other guy, but it fundamentally creates all the issues in terms of creating a quality product, whatever that product is. And just to give an example, controversial move was this demonetization. If you look at it from this perspective, head, body, tail. So you have a certain mission, right? You have a goal that you want to root out black money, which is a noble goal. I mean, assuming that the intent was genuine, I'm not talking about, I presume the intent was there, genuine intent. But then the head is where you think it through, right? Like, okay, what do I do? What are the different alternatives? Okay, these are the different alternatives to get around this. So these are different possibilities. Okay, and you assume that you're going to do, to fight corruption, you're going to do this banknote so that people with wrong banknotes are caught, or too many banknotes are caught. Okay, but then you say that, okay, if I do this, what happens? What are the possibilities? You know, the silliest things is, the problem was not the idea. The problem was in the execution, because when they blocked it, it seems the new banknotes would not come out from the ATM, and that created all this, most of this problem for the common man, right? More than anything else. But they didn't really think like, then how do we keep tab of, who's putting in how much? So again, what I heard from our finance guys itself is, so these bank managers had a field day then. What they used to do is, because everybody had 4,000 rupees, right? Many people, not everybody would stand in line every day to collect that money. So on these dummy names, they would take this money and then they would get a cut from all these black marketers. So those kind of possibilities, you think it through, like, okay, how do I catch that? And then the tail, right? How do I follow up? How do I close it? How do I close the accounts? That whole process needs to be done well. It's not enough to have a surgical strike, right? So I've seen this time and again that, and we are bad at implementation precisely because of this as Indians, right? Pathetic at implementation, because you never take care of the head and tail. When you build a road, you just lay something, put the meat of it, put some tar and done. How should the footpath be? How a person is going to walk? How are the turns going to happen? No, very little, no thought goes about it. And then somebody else will come plant some trees randomly somewhere. Because I had worked on this for some time, and it's a more generic problem. So it's a very good way to think about your work. You know, why is my head, what is my tail? And this is where, you get in your checklist. Here is where you get your strategy in place. Another way to look at work, karma analogy. So if you're familiar with it, there is four kinds of karma, right? So kamya karma, nitya karma, naimittik karma, and nishiddha karma. So kamya karma is basically a desire, right? So you have a desire, you want to make $1,000,000. So what task or what work or what project are actually moving the needle, right? But you cannot be working on moving the needle all the time. Some of the things like a weekly meeting or something needs to be done on regular basis. So nitya means regular, like in that context, your daily rituals, you have to take a bath, you have to brush your teeth. Similarly, nitya karma is something that needs to be done. Incidental is a one-off things. You didn't plan for it. It just happened. It's one thing and it could happen in your day-to-day living that some guest came. You didn't plan for it, but you have to do your karma there. You have to welcome the guest, do your hostly duties, or in your tasks, some tasks come up which are unplanned, and they should the task things that you should not do, right? So that's another way to look at work, things you should not be doing, like create a mess. Another example of effective delegation is first you and this is somewhere I'm also trying to learn is think it through, requirement gathering, give all info. So it's important to you know, when you're delegating, you empower that person upfront, so that you know, he's not left hanging, you know, that he doesn't need to get back to you and give all the information that is required. And then you actually delegate, so the body is delegated. You know, I will not go into this DMG right now, but okay, body is delegated, but then you have your tail again, your checklist, and you have a clear cut acceptance criteria, clear cut definition of done. If you do this, then the delegation starts becoming effective. And this is something where I have put this into practice when I did the for all my team members, when I did this UI UX delegation. So I really thought about it through. I tried to create a clear checklist, and I wanted to get a person who is able to comply, which was actually very hard, because you get some 100 responses, only two or three made that first cut thing, and only one we selected, and we're finding that paid off, right? Because at least it was so hard to get a person who, you know, what I was talking before, right? They will get into the meat, they'll splash around, say a few things here and there, and move off, and you're left, you know, holding the threads, and you have to figure out how to put it all together back. This is a very common problem, and I've struggled with this a lot. And so then how do you take care of it? You do your delegation through this analogy. So why it's important, I mean, it's kind of obvious, but I'm going to state that anyway. So a wealth of a person, right? I mean, all of us are interested in wealth. Is something is very simple, is your value into productivity. So if you're an auto driver, your value is you can drive the auto, right? That is the value you're bringing, and you can drive the auto from point A to point B. So that value has a certain payment. I mean, if you leave aside the petrol cost and diesel cost, maybe it pays you 10 rupees per kilo, 5 rupees per kilometer, or equivalently to say 200, 100, it comes to maybe 80 rupees an hour, some x rupees per hour. That into your productivity, so how many kilometers you drove that day, right? Which is what your Uber and who are those guys were trying to do, right? The more you drive, the more money you get, and so on and so forth. But it's true at every level. I can design analog circuits, so it has a much higher payment, maybe 15 times or 20 times than an auto driver. But then if I can design 5 circuits in 3 months instead of 2 circuits in 3 months, my wealth is that much higher. So your value you bring is your skill, your knowledge, your caliber of thinking. So value is what you can do. Productivity is how much you can do it. So as an individual, at an individual level, again, not many people think along these lines. I mean, so many people, when you interview, you talk, it's like, how much money do I get? They are not thinking, how do I improve the value I give? And in a capitalist system, what people don't realize is, if your manager is half as smart, which, or your owner is as half as smart, if you are being able to get him a value of 100 rupees, he's going to give you 70 rupees for sure, because he's making a profit out of you. And if he gives you 10 rupees, you should be looking somewhere else. But then you are trying to see, I mean, I'm saying in a very generic sense, people are not thinking, how do I increase my value? And the few people who do, I think in terms of skill, okay, which is one, but they don't think in terms of productivity. They think in terms of skill and knowledge. Some people do that, which is why they do degrees. But I mean, at a very money level also, these things match yourself. And when it comes to a company, the value of a company is nothing but the value of the individual wealths, right? So it is just a summation. But again, if some thought or some knowledge or some caliber is put into that summation, that can become more towards a multiplication. But it's basically the sum of individuals at a very baseline level. So whether it's a company or even a nation, right? It's just that it's the caliber of thinking and the productivity that you get in, which is what is creating that wealth. And so there are two aspects to it. So one is that, and the second is the speed aspect. Your execution can be very streamlined, very well planned, and happens in a smooth manner. So you, otherwise you're constantly running into roadblocks, niggles, things here and there which trouble you. Again, at an individual level, you can look at it as a, also as a, how do I develop capability. Now again, this is something which people don't think or they don't pursue in education, right? Which, when I started this, my perspective is, how do I build this person's capability? It's not about how I teach math. I have to do all these other things so that people don't feel I'm doing something very exotic, right? People are very, parents cannot, so the problem with our whole system is nobody thinks. So then they are not able to think. The herd mentality and advertisement, and if Shah Rukh Khan comes, though he has absolutely nothing to do with education, he doesn't himself know how to give his child education. But if Shah Rukh Khan comes, it has value. So this, unfortunately, this lack of thinking and stupidity has seeped into majority of the population. So they really don't know. But essentially, you should be thinking, how do I develop my own capability? So if you have a task, right, like you want to go to a bank and open an account, from your capability point of view, it's probably straightforward. You can do it, but it may not be easy for maybe somebody who's uneducated or a villager or something like that, right, who's rustic. So you have one level of capability, but for somebody like David Allen, for example, he can take maybe 150 of these and manage it, right? He's got a different level of capability. You can send emails, you can respond well, you communicate well. That's another level of capability. Maybe one more level is you can manage meetings, and it's very easy, and you are able to present well, or you're able to conceptualize, you're able to visualize, you're able to deliver, and so on and so forth. So you can keep building. So for example, this number 1, 2, 3, 4 is extremely simple for Elon Musk, right? I mean, he's just like we have black belt, right? Level 1, he's probably at black belt 6, and we are probably at 2, right? Somebody else is at 1. So we don't see how we can improve our black belt number, which is a capability number. So so that's one. So then what happens is, when you develop capability, multitasking or handling multiple projects start looking easier and easier, right? So that's one way to look at it. Yeah, it's the way to forward to health, wealth, and happiness, but most of all time. So again, we if you think like this, how is wealth built? And I'm not saying that I'm there or I'm this thing, but one question will come is like, see, this is something that needs continuous work over a period of time. It does not happen overnight. It's one more, you have one foot in this, and of course you have to do your daily stuff, but over a period of time you develop this thing. And actually David Allen, he wrote that, you know, somebody asked him, how much time does it take to implement your GTD system? And he said 3 years. So this itself takes time. It's not something which you start today and you are like there tomorrow, but you start today, you get some incremental benefit tomorrow, and slowly it improves. So in my case, for example, it has really helped, you know, and you guys know me already. And so, for example, I have maybe, 20 years of experience in circuits, and I've shifted field, right? Shifting fields is very hard. Very few people do it. In your field, you can do a lot of stuff. When you shift fields completely, like I have tried and doing, it's actually very, very hard to re-accomplish that success, which is why I'm struggling. I mean, if I'd done it in my field, it would have been very easy. But then, okay, you have so many years of experience, it pays you very well, you know you're successful. How do I make use of that, right? I mean, two ways. One is to the community, because you have 20 years of ingrained gray matter, right? It's gray matter. It's deeply embedded in your muscle memory. Plus, the kind of revenue it brings because of your experience, your knowledge, your abilities that you have developed is also huge. But then, to do that again needs time, right? You need to give something substantial chunk. If you give a very small thing, it's too small for you and for the other person. So how do you utilize it, right? So you have to work these things out. And at least, so that's a domain, because it's a good test domain that I'm very aware of, right? In a domain which you're not good at, you're exploring still, right? I mean, when I got into education, I was because I am a researchy guy, I read up all these Montessori things and all. What I didn't realize is that doesn't tell you how to run a school. It doesn't tell you how to handle teachers. It doesn't tell you how to judge teachers, right? Same thing with business. So this, all these areas were so new. So this was an area which which my domain expertise already exists. So it's an area where I can test out, you know, these theories more easily. And it really worked, because I find I'm far more productive today than I was 10 years ago, or 5 years ago, even 4 years ago. So I had taken one more assignment and I had to leave it, right? Because I could not handle both of it. It was getting overwhelming, right? I know I was not doing well on the school, nothing was moving, and this is something you want to do. But now I'm able to open book, close the book, and they are extremely happy. I'm able to deliver without it interfering. So when I close that book, I close that book. I can completely switch over. And I'm in fact saying that I will take a little bit more responsibility for more money. So at least I can run this in a sustainable manner. So I find that less and less is being stuck because of me now. I'm not the bottleneck so much anymore. So it works. It is. I'm just giving an example. It works. It is doable. I think. So I mean, this is like, I think to our team members, I keep talking about it, but I thought I'll just make it a formal thing, because all that research or whatever has happened, right? So you also have an idea on this. And I invited a few other people, so I think not many of them came, because again, people don't schedule, they don't have a calendar. It's not that they didn't want to come, but I didn't send reminders. I was like, if they remember, they will come. Because when I talked to them, they wanted to attend something like this. So this is a problem, right? I mean, this is also, especially people who are working, who are busy, right? Especially entrepreneurs, they want to, but they forget. And something else, they are in Q1, they are firefighting most of the time. So. Yeah, I think that's it. I'm done. Okay, so these are some references. Getting Things Done, David Allen. 4-Hour Workweek. So don't try this with me. But it's a good book to show how you... Basically, he's saying you specialize in what you are good at and leave everything to other specialists. That's the nature of the way the world is moving, right? I mean, we are productive because we specialize, right? So his thing is that I actually registered for this. I became a member of this Asian Efficiency and listened to a few podcasts. And there's one on hiring, that's also very important. So those kind of things. There's again a lot of stuff there, but this is the stuff which is like curated, right? After a lot, going through a lot, these are really good. So I'm putting only the really good stuff and not all the other random stuff which I've seen so much. Okay, so thank you very much. So we are